I thank you. I thank you, Lord God, that I'm breathing, that I'm alive. I thank you that I can walk around in my own home. I don't sleep in the car. I have food in my refrigerator. I have breath in my lungs. I have my
glass. So at this time, I want to introduce Pastor Archie Thompkins. Amen.
Glory!
Little do you know, I needed that. Y'all don't mind if I switch microphones, right? Come on, give God some praise in this house. I don't know about you. Top of the Mountain Christian Ministry is not making this easy. I just want y'all to know, I just like to thank God for my awesome wife. Who put up with my funny ways. And I do have some funny ways. There's sometimes I'm very picky, and sometimes I can be a little over-spiritual, if you know what that means. But you know, I told her one time, and she left me alone, that what you see is what you get. I want to be right in God. That's all I ever wanted. That's all I ever wanted. It's been a struggle for me ever since I had that operation on my vertebrates. It's been a challenge for me to stay close to God, to solid stay close to God. And you were on point there, Sister Nett, something you told me. You was on point. I just want you to know, if she's on point, I really encourage you to tell her, because when you're on point, when you speak of something that God is giving you, then she should know. You ain't got to tell me or nobody else, but you tell her that she's on point. That keeps her bonded in the spirit of God. Said, okay, God, I know I did what you asked me to do. Like I said, it's been a challenge for me. I praise God hard, because if I don't praise God hard, anxiety takes over. But how many of you know the devil's a liar? No knife, no vertebrate damage. Nothing can stop you from praising God. Amen. I can honestly say, I'm not going to be long. No. Because a lot of things said today was already in the message. So I don't have to go over that twice. That's how you know when you're on point with God. Amen. And I want to tell each and every one of you right now, this is the problem people have. They want to wait until they're in a coffin or a cremated vase to tell they love you. I love each and every single one of you. On purpose. We got to be accountable for one another here, not just here out there. We spend too much time talking and not correcting. Too much time forgetting and not praying. They'll be all right. They'll be all right. Lord, the Lord's going to help them. How many of you know that God wants us to help one another? That's why he hasn't stepped in and helped that person, because he wants you to do it. Because little do you know, when you step in and help a person, you're also helping you. That's a mission for you. God is going to be God. He's God and God alone. But everything he does has an order to it. You pray for me because I was going through. And all of a sudden, God reveals something to you you didn't even know you had. This is what it's all about, family. Amen? Amen. And wherever he's going with family, I want to be. I want to be with that family. God always been about family. Always been about family. From Adam and Eve to Noah, he always been about family. He might destroy the world with water, but he kept Noah and his family. Because him and Jesus are family. When you got a son, that's a family. Understand, if I want to leave you with this, be a family. Do not be a church. Be a family. Church can be played. A family can't. A family that is real. When I was little, I used to watch Leave It to Beaver, Fathers Know Best. Yes, I'm telling my age, and ain't nothing wrong with it. And I always admired the family. But that's a TV family. Who knows that Barbara Bensley really was a good mom? Nobody knows. But her strip, what they was paying for her to do, is to be the best mom. They sent out a positive note to the world. They might not know what they was doing, but it set a positive note. And it set a bar for me that was high. I didn't get that at home. It set a bar for me that was high. Amen? But I can get it in here. Now that my life has changed, my family has changed, I get it when I go home. They are now longing for me to come home. Before, they couldn't wait to get rid of me. Now they are longing for me to come home because who I am. I left a family to me that wasn't put together all the way what I was looking for. And I joined a I am family, which is of God. He says, I am, so you be I am. And when I went back home, they embraced me because I was no more that tyrant, that liar, that cheat, that crazy one, that Mad Max nickname I had. Family. What are we going to do, family? A family that prays together, do what? Stays together. A family that gets separated, that means you allow something to come between you. You allow Satan to somehow get in. You know what? He's not even our present. He can't be everywhere. So you brought him in your home. You allow him to ride your back like a horse and drove him right into your living room. This message is for Christian folks. The saved. Amen? Amen. Please stand to your feet. Oh, Lord, you're working. As we pray, let us pray. Dear and Father, we just thank you right now, Lord God, that we are all alive and well and stand forth here, Lord God, in your presence. Father, I yield to you now. Search me from head to toe. Remove anything from me that's not like you and replace it with you, Father. Father, I yield to you. Let it be all of you and none of me, Father. Father, let your word do not fall on deaf ear, Father. Prepare the spirits to harden the mind to receive what thus says the Lord. Father, I ask you to continue, Lord God, to keep this family growing, to keep this family tight-knit, to keep this family, Lord God, like that three strain that cannot be broken, to keep them strong in you, Father, and prepare them for new heights in you. Father, I give you all the glory, honor, and praise. In Jesus' name we do pray. Amen. Amen. Today we're coming out of Exodus. Exodus 12. And when you're there, please say amen. Familiar passage. We have taught on this. We have preached on this. And I asked God, okay, we're going to Exodus. He said, because I need to take you back there for something they need to take out of what happened and bring it into the now, as Pastor always say. Amen. 12, starting at verse 1. It says, the Lord said to Moses and Aaron in Egypt, This month is to be for you the first month of your year. Tell the whole community of Israel that on the 10th day of this month, each man is to take a lamb for his family, one for each household. If any household is too small for a whole lamb, they must share one with their nearest neighbor. Having taken this into account, the number of people there are, you are to determine the amount of lamb needed in accordance with what each person will eat. Verse 5, the animal you choose must be a year old without defect, and you may take them from the sheep or the goats. Take care of them until the 14th day of the month, when all the members of the community of Israel must slaughter them at twilight. Verse 7 says, then they are to take some of the blood and put it on the sides and the tops of the door frames of the household where we're there to eat the lamb. Verse 8, that same night they are to eat the meat roasted over the fire along with the bitter herbs and bread made without yeast. Verse 9, do not eat the meat raw or boiled in water, but roast it over a fire with the head, legs, and the internal organs. Verse 10, do not leave any of it till morning. If some of it is left till morning, you must burn it. This is how you are to eat it, with your cloak tucked into your belt, your sandals on, your feet and your staff in your hand. Eat it in haste. It is the Lord's Passover. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. Amen. So, I know you're wondering where is God is going with this. He's saying that it's time to mark your doorpost and then post up. He said there's something coming that you saints need to be prepared for in the house of the Lord. It's why he's talking to us, the saints. Amen? Amen. God is saying that there is some correction that about to come to the earth, and we must be prepared so that we can be passed over from his correction and judgment. He said, go back to the beginning when I passed over my chosen ones, Israel, and I saved them from destruction and correction and judgment. Amen? Now, you know this passage where Moses and Aaron was to go to Egypt and tell Pharaoh to let the people go, God's people. Amen? They didn't want to do that. But God said, I have to show them that I am God. How many of you know that God will prove himself? He don't have to prove himself, but he will show up and prove himself. Amen? If you just allow him to be God, God will be God. Amen? So when he told them, he gave them specific instructions on what to do to mark their post. Amen? This is what God wants you to do. Take it back from the beginning to prepare for something is coming. When they did this, they did it in the direction of God. Moses and Aaron did exactly what God had said. He told them what to slaughter, what time to slaughter. He told them to mark their doorposts. Amen. When I read verse 4, but if your family is small and don't need a whole lamb, they must share one with their nearest neighbors. Amen. Help. That's all I hear. God say, help. 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 Your nearest neighbor. Who is your nearest neighbor? I'm not talking about your neighborhood, who is your neighbor. I'm talking about, let's explore this. Now, when he talked to the Israelites, he said the Israel community. That means everybody was in there that God had already planned to save them. So your nearest neighbor is your brother and sister in Christ. Amen? Amen? He's talking to a community of Christians. He wants you to help them. Everybody is not going to get it like you. Amen? There are weak ones in the Christian community that don't even know how to mark their posts. Amen? Or how to get to that point. But you already know how to mark your post. And if you don't, before this is done, you shall. God wants to take this from then of Exodus and bring it into June today. He's saying that you don't just mark your post just once. He said you got to continue to mark your post to keep things out. Amen? Remember what I said. If the devil is sitting in your living room, you invited him or he rode your back into your house. Amen? Murder, killing, lies, cheating, stealing, terrorists. But are they going to touch a child of God? No. Understand that your post that you need to mark is not just the house of the Lord. It's your own house and your children's house. Fine example. Marking the post when kids did prayer in school, you didn't have nobody gun them down. Soon as they voted on taking prayer out of school, what happened? They start shooting kids. Somebody allowed them to take the mark off the post. And let me tell you something. This is the sad part. Some of them was Christians. They voted and allowed the school to take out prayer. So now the school is not marked for destruction can pass them by. In God we trust is on the money of the United States. In God we trust it was founded on. Start talking about taking in God we trust off the money. Start doing what it means to in God we trust. Look what's happening to the United States. We're not no more a superpower like we think. Because we ain't trusting God no more. We're trusting in weapons. We're not trusting God no more. We want to pay somebody else to do our dirty work. If you're not prepared for this Passover, you will get caught up in that nonsense. When you are talking every day about the same president, you wish they impeach him, you wish all this stuff, you can get caught up in that nonsense. I serve one God and one God only. You need to prepare your family and the house of the Lord to get passed over what is coming. I don't know when and I don't know what, but he says you got to be ready, you got to be prepared to get passed over. The first thing people think, I'm a Christian, nothing is going to happen to me. Are you living like a Christian? Are you walking like a Christian? Are you talking like a Christian? Are you studying like a Christian? If you can check all those off, by all means, you just sit back and eat your lamb. Amen. Sit in your chair with your girdle on. You can sit right there with your walking stick and your sandals tied, and you're ready to go when God said go. But if you're not, God said that every firstborn will be struck down, human and animal. That's what he told Israel, what he told Moses. Amen? What he told Aaron. So he's telling me, if you ain't behind that blood, then you out there. Saints, we got to take this seriously. We don't just give our life to Christ and stop. We don't just receive the blood of Jesus and stop. Some of us need to check our salvation. I don't have a problem with that. Need to check the salvation. Did I give my life to Christ? Or did grandma tell me to stand up? Did I give my life to Christ? Or I was following Sister Jones, so it's because she came up there, I went up there. Did I give my life to Christ? Or did I thought the pastor was calling my name? He was looking at me funny, so I better go up before he says something. I understand. The only way you're going to mark the post is to be with Jesus Christ, to be reborn again. This is a spiritual thing today. What God does, he takes a spiritual thing
and bring it into the natural. He take a spiritual thing and bring it into natural. When you all got anointed today, and Elder Nett was telling you what the Lord was saying, a spiritual thing, he was talking to her in the spirit, and she brought it in the natural. When you mark your post, when the Israelites mark their post, right? The spiritual thing, God talking to Aaron and Moses, putting the blood on the door, following the instructions about how they slaughtered the lamb, a lamb without blemish, they took the spiritual thing, brought it in the natural. How many of you know that the reason why they was behind the blood? How many of you know that when they marked that post, they was behind the blood, the door, waiting for God to release them to go where he needed them to go? How many people opened the door before the angel was done? How many opened the door before the angel was done? They opened the door to death. They opened the door to destruction. How many ministries was behind the blood of Jesus, but they went before God said go? It's in, comes out. You know what? When the pastor calls you up here, or any person, any man and woman of God, right, that who is blood-wise, spirit-filled, that's the qualifier I put on there, anoint you with anointing oil. He cannot save you. He cannot do anything besides what God tells him to do. So what he's doing is marking your posts for when he prays for you. Hear me. When he prays for you, anything out there cannot come into you. Amen. That means that what he's praying to get out of you, if you got issues, now don't get me wrong, there are spirits, there are demons. If he prays to get some out of you, when it comes out, it cannot go back in because he marked your post. In the name of Jesus. The only way whatever that is that you got out of you can come back into you if you open the door too soon. When you open the door too soon, you coming from behind the blood. That means you are picking up anything and everything that just left. Marking your posts is important. The Israelites stayed there until the angel of death was done. And then God, did you see what God said? Gird up. Have your shirt ready, your shirt tucked in your pants. Have your shoes on, whatever they're Nikes or Converts. Have them on and have your walking stick. What is your walking stick? Your orders of Jesus. Those are my marching orders. So when God was done and he said, go, you are ready to go. There's a lot of people need help out there. But first, we got to protect ourselves first. You can't help nobody when you wide open. I can't help my brother if I'm sitting in the open myself. Like Pastor said one time about that airplane, when that mask come down because we lose spiritual altitude, the first thing I need to do is put on my mask so I can help somebody else. Because if I pass out before I get to you, I'm no use to you. Church, saints, when we lose spiritual altitude, we have to get God to climb us back into him. We can't help nobody out there because we ain't help nobody in here. We have to prepare what God has. What he has for us, we got to be able to receive it. And God only flows to God. It works the same way. God flows to God. Whatever flows through his throne comes back to him. Wherever word he sends out never come back to him void, which means empty. It always do what he sends it out to do. Amen? So when the lamb was done, the ultimate sacrifice came for us, which is Jesus Christ. He gave up the blood.
There's no other sacrifice needed. No other sacrifice. No traditions. None of these rituals. There's none needed. Amen. We have to prepare the church what's about to take place. The church is the only one that can change the nations. The only one. No Congress, no government, nobody. It is the church, family, God's people. But before then, you got to mark your post, because don't think Satan is not going to fight back. He's going to fight you tooth and nail, not for you to pray. He's going to fight you tooth and nail, not to help someone. Amen? Understand, church, we got to prepare ourselves to receive what's going on. When Peter denied Jesus 3 times, that was hard. But when Jesus asked Peter, "Do you love me?" 3 times, that was a blessing. Every time Peter said yes, Jesus gave a commandment. 3 times. And I always, when I studied that scripture, saw everything that you said you denied Jesus, he had to come back and make you say you do believe in him 3 times. Prepare yourself. Amen. Jesus marked Peter outside to prepare what was inside. He marked Peter on the outside by questioning him, "Do you love me?" And every time Peter answered and he gave him a commandment, right? When they had finished eating, Jesus said to Simon Peter, "Simon, son of John, do you love me more than these?" "Yes, Lord," he said, "you know I love you." Jesus said, "Feed my lambs." Again, Jesus said to Simon, son of John, "Do you love me?" He answered, "Yes, Lord, you know I love you." Jesus said, "Take care of my sheep." Number two. Now, number three says, the third time he said to him, "Simon, son of John, do you love me?" Peter was hurt. How many people in the house of the Lord get hurt when you just ask them a question? I'm not judging you. I'm trying to help you to stay out of judgment's way. Amen. He was hurt. Jesus asked him the third time, "Do you love me?" He said, "Lord, you know all things. You know that I love you." Jesus said, "Feed my sheep." Preparing him for ministry. Even blessed him enough to let him know how he was going to die. If you knew how you was going to die, would you act the way you're acting now? If you knew the day, the time, and the hour that you was going to leave this earth, would you be acting the way you are now? If Jesus came down here himself and said, "I am coming back in 10 days. Whoever doorpost is not marked, I am leaving them." I bet you will go out and try to find a lamb or something to slaughter, whatever he tell you. I bet you whole house, you go and buy truckloads of anointing oil and just pour it from the roof and let it run down to the ground. Because he said so. Some people say seeing is believing. Have you seen enough? Have you not seen enough? When your children and you leave that house every morning, are you marking their post in prayer? It don't always have to be the anointing oil, prayer. Are you praying to the Lord for protection? Are you praying Psalms 91 around them before they go catch the bus or before they get in school? You can't be in the school. I don't care how much you FaceTime your child. Once that camera goes off, guess what? Satan comes on. Are you marking the posts of your children? Are you sending them out with prayer and ahead of them? Are you coming in the house of the Lord prayed up? You have to be. Amen? Teach your children the way to go. The Bible said that they will never turn away from you. Teach them. Teach them like the Israelites. Once they did the Passover, Amen. And they was passed by. He told Moses and Aaron to tell them that when your children ask, tell them we did this and we doing this in remembrance of the Lord that passed us over. That means they are spreading the word of God to the youth. Amen. The youth is the future. Don't think it's you. You sitting there 80, 90 years old and then talking about the youth is the youth and the future is me. You better get up out of here. The youth is the future. And youth, the people under you, is the future. You learn from us, then teach them. And they will teach another. But you teach them the word of God. Amen? We have to raise them up the way they should go. Amen? Can I get you two here for a second? I want to show you something. Youth. Elderly. Yeah, we elderly. Amen. You know, this is how it looks when you do this, when I'm talking about. Pastor, get on the right. Pastor, when you get on the left, please. Amen. Get your praying hands up, please. I know this is your love, favorite motion. When you walk down towards the camera, I want you to walk, you to go left, and I want Pastor to go right and come back to this point. Amen. This where it begins. The man or woman of God is marking the posts of the church. This is where it begins. They didn't just stop in their own house. They started by the throne room of God, right? And they're going to end up with the throne room of God. Amen. Amen. Can I get you two for a second? Just give me 1 minute. Somebody has got to have their back. Can you stand behind them, please? Woman behind woman, man behind man. Now I need you to do the same exact thing. Somebody's got to have their back. Amen. Go ahead. Somebody has got to help you to understand that we're in this together. That's why when they talk about it, the family is too small. Amen. It says share the lamb with them. You know, when I think about that too small, that means somebody is not as strong as you. Somebody might get tired. Jesus sent them out in twos. For when one get tired, the other one can continue to pray. Then they will always come back to the same point. Amen. Can I get two kids? Any two kids? Come on up. You two. You two. Y'all come on. Right there. Y'all step forward just for a minute. I need you two right there behind them. Now, go ahead, you two. When the person on your right go right, you go right. The person on your left go left. Amen. Please sit when you get there. When you get there, please sit. Amen. Back to God. You two, when you get here, please sit. Nope, you two stay. Thank you. It started here. Then back up. Then the elder kids. And it ends up with them. This is how it continued to flow back to the throne of God. If you don't mark your post, you know what? Some people say, I'm going to mark my post. I'm going home and mark your post. Guess what? They're my post and they don't live in my house. They're my post. They're my post. They don't live in my house. You're my post. You're my post. You don't live in my house. Help. I know what you're going to say. It's all kind of help. Yeah, of course it is. Wrong help, bad help, lazy help, selfish help, no help. We're talking about the spiritual help of God. We got to get to this point This is what God is saying. We are not to this point. We have got to prepare them. You can go sit down. I thank you very much. Give them a hand, please. We got to prepare them for what thus says the Lord. Why allow them to be wiped out before their turn comes? Why? The devil wants to take them out. You notice I started, I like to call them the powerhouse. I started with the powerhouse first. First line of defense. So if we are in front of them, the devil can't touch them. We are their shield. We're sending our kids to a school that's being gunned down, being lost in the social media, without marking them. And when I say mark them, that means anoint them. That means that you're praying for them before. I used to pray, me and my wife prayed together in the morning, and God spoke to me, and I got up one morning, and I said, you know what? I start praying before my daughter catches the bus, before she get out. Then I pray with my wife again. God has told me this. He's saying you got to do it before you open the door with the mark posts, because something is waiting out there for you, for your children. I'm going to tell you, my neighbors thought I was crazy when I moved in the neighborhood, because I was out there praising the Lord, marking my posts. This is mine, especially if I saw a snake one time. I was out there praying and calling down all strongholds. I said, Lord, you know I don't like them. And you said I had the authority to command. I command the snake and his brothers and his sisters that they'll never dot my land again. And I've been 3 years ago, and I ain't seen one. How much do you believe? Your faith, you got to believe that when you mark your post, that it's going to be secured and nothing can penetrate that barrier. Nothing. Let me tell you, God revealed to me this morning about me marking the post of the home. My wife be tripping on me too. I ain't done with her yet. She said, you a prayer, why are you anointing things you bring in the house? I said, nothing come in here unless I anoint it. I pray over my stuff. I have to. There's things that are out there that bump in the night. I'm here to tell you, they will come out to play. They'll come out like Chucky to play. But if your post is anointed and is marked, they can't even get in to play. You can invite anybody you want to your house, and your house is anointed and marked and covered in prayer. When they walk in, whatever they have, they got to check the spirit at the door. That spirit can't come in there. They're coming, but that spirit can't go. I'm telling you, they're going to take it off like the shoes. You check that demon at the door. We can talk. When you get out there, it's your choice if you want to pick that thing up or not. Check the demon at the door. You got to start this thing. You don't invite anything into your home. And God gave me the confirmation this morning by me anointing our home was this. When me and my wife was installed as assistant pastors, that same morning, we had service. We had a blessed time in the Lord. Went home to prepare, right? To prepare. We didn't know we was going to be assistant pastors on that day. You know our pastor is. He likes to spring surprises. But he was going in the order of God. That same morning, a lady took her own life on our street. And I didn't think about it till this morning. My neighbor told me, he said, I saw this strange woman walking down here. I spoke to her. She said, good morning. She walked, and he told me she was standing in front of your house. He said she walked in front of your house for a while. And then he said she turned, walked outside of the street to the right, and shot herself. That is sad. But he showed me the example. If you did not have anointed your home, if you did not mark your posts, if you did not been praying, then she could have came in there and did what she want. But the post was marked.
So when the angel of death or destruction or an imp or a gimp came and they saw that blood of Jesus right there, they had to say, oh, can't do it here. Let me go down the street and do it now. You see me? She had to leave the premises because it belongs to God. She had to leave it. She couldn't kill herself in front of my house as much as she wanted to. She couldn't do it. She had to leave. And you know what else? She didn't even do it on 214 Pagonia Lane Street. She went outside of the street. I always pray for our neighborhood and our street. She went outside of the street that we live on and did it. Outside. It's sad that Satan used someone like that. Saints, it's time to get your postmarked. It's time for you to mark the territory that God has given you. I say mark, not mock. Mark. I know I speak German sometimes and get words all flimsy like that, but not today. Mark. Pray over your kids. Pray over their church home. Pray over your schools and the jobs and your vehicle. Anoint things in your home. Because when I said in the blood of Jesus, nothing come past this point. It's the same with you. When you are preparing yourself for this Passover that God is talking about, think about tsunamis in different countries. Hurricane. I live in Virginia. We used to have hurricanes all the time. I have seen one with these eyes. And I have been in a house where I saw things flying around it all in the air. And never was touched. A school in the state of Gloucester, Virginia, smashed to bits. And not one child was hurt. Because you know why? Your child was in there that you covered. When your child is in there that you covered, she's coming out. Or he's coming out. How many more are they going to bring with them? So understand, it ain't just you. It's your children. When you go to school, you pray. I don't care what they said. Prayer is not, you can't do it in school. Do it before you get to school. So you know what? They lost because prayer is coming into school because I'm in there. I walked in there. Soon as I show up, prayer is here. Prayer. Cover the church. Cover your family. I can't stress this enough. I don't know what's coming. But whatever it is, you got to be ready and covered and prepared. That way destruction won't come your way. No disease can take you to your knees. You cannot be fooled. You cannot be fooled. Amen. Please stand to your feet. How do you do this? How do you prepare for something that you don't know what it is or you don't know what it looks like? How did Israel prepare for it? How did Moses prepare for it? He did exactly what God told him. But I have to warn you about something. If your house ain't clean, don't try to mark it. It's like you know what I mean. It's like you painting over dirt. When you paint over dirt, it's going to take you a lot of quarts, a lot of paints, a lot of gallons. And then, this is what the funny part is, once you paint it, right, you go off and think you did it. In the morning you wake up, there it is again, shining through the paint. You can't get rid of sin by painting it over. You can't get rid of sin by telling people you're marking God's post. God knows what's his. He knows what's his. I'm telling you right now, what took place up here at the altar already, if you ain't right or you didn't get what God wanted you to get, by all means, I'm not going to stop you. By all means, come. But I'm telling you, that was so powerful this morning of the things that took place here in God. He wanted you. He wanted to prepare you. He wanted you to be anointed. He wanted you to be. Do you hear me? We got to be prepared. You got to get ready as we prepare for, even for communion. If that didn't prepare you, you know what? We still here. We still here. But I still can go to keep going, continue to go through the petitions. The first, if you did not ever knew Jesus Christ as your Savior, that means you haven't confessed with your mouth that Jesus is Lord. You haven't believed in your heart that God raised him from the dead. Then you need to come. Because that means that you don't know and never confessed it. That means you didn't accept him as your Savior. You'd have heard about it. You hear all the kids talking about it. You hear other people talking about it. But if you have never, this is your time. Amen. Second one, if you knew Jesus Christ and you backslid. Amen. You did something where you out of the grace of God. Amen. One thing puts you out of the grace of God, walking away from him. And we're not talking about save, always save. You save when you walk towards Christ and do what he wants. But when you walk away from Christ, you leave him salvation with him. Please come. And if you feel like you just didn't get what you needed this very day, and you need prayer, we have pastors and ministers and deacons that will pray for you and with you. I'm not talking about they're going to go word for word what they think. I'm talking about they're going to get with God and pray with you. They're going to agree what you want to pray for as long as something that is going to line up with the will of God. Amen. If I need to go through it again, raise your hand. If I don't, we'll continue to move. I don't want to leave anybody out. I don't want to leave that neighbor that needs to taste the lamb. I need to share with the lamb that I have. We have to share with our nearest neighbors, which is our brothers and sisters. Do you know that some people living next door to Christians, and I'm talking about true Christians, the meaning of Jesus Christ, watching them just eat dust. Never went over there, can I help you? What can I do? A matter of fact, you shouldn't even have to ask. Here you are. God bless you. How did you know that I need this? Because my posts were marked. And you're my nearest neighbor. And God said to share what I had with you. That way you can come with me to the promised land. That's why the Israelites died off before they all could get in there. Joshua was a new regime. I can't take this in there. I need somebody who is really sold out for God. Amen. Is everybody at home? I do believe. Amen. Amen. Come on, give God some praise. Come on, you can, hey, come on, I thought we was marking the post. You know, God is so good. He's so wonderful. He's so great. We are doing communion, correct? Okay. Amen. So I'm telling you that we really have to be on alert. We really have to be on alert. Set your alarm. And sound it when you get up. Sound it when you get up. Let me tell you, some people believe that you have to have both feet on the floor in the praying position to pray to God. No. I can open my eyes and begin to shout to God on my back. Because when I do that, that means when I stand up, I won't fall. You have to do it. We need one another. We need each other. This is the thing. You're going to need each other more than ever, whatever God got's coming. He's about to do a new thing. Let him choose you like he chose the Israelites. Amen. You can destroy this temple. I will rebuild it in 3 days. Foolish people thought that he meant the temple.
That's a man-made thing.